Hi, welcome to Why the Look Elsewhere Effect is Important. Let's say you have a friend who is trying to convince you that they have a working system for picking winning lottery numbers. There are multiple ways to win on a given ticket. Your friend specializes in choosing numbers to win a medium-sized prize. A ticket has a 1 in 1,000 chance of winning one of these medium prizes. Your friend tells you that they started using this system just this past week, and they already won the medium prize once. That sounds pretty impressive, and you start to wonder if they are onto something. Then they tell you that they bought 100 lottery tickets in that time. Is their win still all that impressive? Let's get the probability, assuming their system does not work and thus performs the same as random chance, that they would win the medium prize their first week. To get this, let's first get the probability that they would not win a prize. Now, the probability for a given ticket to win the medium prize is 1 in 1,000, or 0.001. The probability that the ticket will not win the prize is 999 out of 1,000, or 0.999. Now, the probability that all 100 tickets would not win the prize is 0.999 raised to the power of 100, which is approximately 0.905. So, the probability that your friend would win one or more of the medium prizes out of these 100 tickets is 1 minus the number we just calculated, so 1 minus 0.999 raised to the 100 power, which is approximately 0.095, or 9.5%. Now, the probability that they would win exactly one medium prize is the probability of losing on 99 tickets times the probability of winning on one ticket times the number of combinations in which that can happen. So that's 0.999 raised to the 99th power times 0.001 times 100 tickets, which is about 9.1%. And this is only slightly smaller than the probability of winning one or more of the medium prizes. Okay, so the probability of your friend winning in the first week is not small. If they played the same number of tickets every week, we would expect them to win a medium prize every 10 weeks or so. This means there really isn't any compelling evidence that your friend's system for choosing numbers works. Now, we could have estimated the probability of winning a prize by multiplying the probability of a given ticket winning, 0.001, by the number of tickets, which was 100. This gives an estimated probability of 10%, which isn't too far off. In this estimate, the factor of 100, the number of tickets, is the number of ways that a win could occur. This is an example of a trials factor, the number of trials in which the effect could have occurred. The look elsewhere effect is basically a statement that you have to include trials factors when you're determining how unusual an observed event is. The name of the term refers to the fact that you have to look at all of the possible ways the seemingly unusual event, here winning the medium prize, could happen. So, in our example here, your friend's winning of a medium prize in the first week that they are playing sounds really unusual because the probability of a given ticket winning is only 1 in 1,000. But when you take into account the look elsewhere effect, you look at all of the tickets they played, and it turns out that their winning of a prize wasn't that odd at all. Now, let's look at a couple of examples from the world of science. For example, let's look at the experiments taking place at the Large Hadron Collider at CERN. The experiments there do many things, such as looking for hypothesized particles and measuring production and decay rates of known particles. For example, even in a search for a single new particle, physicists may do many, many different measurements. They may consider multiple ways that the particle can be produced and/or decay. These require separate measurements. Also, they likely do not know the mass of the hypothetical particle that they are looking for, so they have to look for it in different mass ranges. Consider a hypothetical scenario in which one of the LHC experiments looks for a particle that we'll call X. Let's say that for a particular value of the X mass, they obtain a result that is compatible with the production of the X. Their result doesn't necessarily mean that they've discovered the X. Due to measurement uncertainties, it is possible to obtain a result like this even if the X doesn't exist. But let's say that their result is unusual enough that if the X doesn't exist with that value of its mass, the probability that they would have obtained a result this compelling is only 1 in 1,000. In other words, if the X doesn't exist and have that mass, their result is really, really weird. It might be quite tempting to get excited about this result. And in fact, this might be evidence of the X particle's existence. However, the LHC experiments by this point have done thousands of different measurements. This means that over their history, the trials factor for these experiments is quite large. And some results that look this compelling are going to pop up by sheer chance, even if the new physics scenarios that are being looked for don't actually exist. So, taking into account the look elsewhere effect, having a result like this once in a while is not unexpected. So while a 1 in 1,000 result may look very interesting, only more study will determine if it is a real discovery or a fluke that arises out of the huge set of measurements done by the experiments. For more information on scenarios like this, you may wish to check out the videos in the Discoveries in Particle Physics playlist. Additionally, you may be interested in the video, What's a P-Value? In the language of that latter video, our 1 in 1,000 result in the scenario above is a result with a p-value of 0.001. The look elsewhere effect is one reason particle physicists have very strict criteria for when to call an experimental result a discovery. For more information, you can check out the video 5 Sigma, the standard for discovery in particle physics. Now, let's look at a second example. Let's imagine that you work in a lab trying to develop a drug that will alleviate the symptoms of some medical condition in cats. You have tested your formula on a set of patients, and it appears to work. You understand your measurement uncertainties, and you conclude that if the drug doesn't work, the probability that you'd get a result that looks this promising is only 1 in 500. So you are quite optimistic about the formula. However, let's argue that your lab has been working on this problem for years, and this is the 40th formula that they've tried. Is your result still compelling? After trying 40 different formulae, the probability of getting a result that looks this compelling, even if none of the formulations actually work, is not so small. So you definitely should take into account the look elsewhere effect before concluding that this formula works. Follow-up studies may be a good idea. Okay, let's summarize. In this video, we've seen the look elsewhere effect. If you wish to judge how unusual an experimental result is, you need to know if the result is a solitary measurement or part of a large set of measurements. This is because if you do enough measurements, eventually you will obtain some results that look interesting, even if, in reality, they aren't.